This episode of Standard Orbit is brought to you by Audible.com, offering more than 180,000 titles for smartphone, tablet, and desktop. To get a free audiobook of your choice and help Trek FM at the same time, visit audibletrial.com/trekfm. And also by Enterprise in Space, an international program for the nonprofit National Space Society. Find out how you can help science and education and become a virtual crew member aboard the NSS Enterprise Orbiter by visiting enterpriseinspace.org. Want to join the conversation and share your thoughts on this episode? Join the Babel Conference, our listeners group on Facebook. Just type B-A-B-E-L into the Facebook search field. We look forward to seeing you there.
This is Walter Koenig, Chekhov from Star Trek, and you're listening to Trek FM.
Risk is our business.
It's like nothing we've dealt with before.
By golly, Jim, I'm beginning to think I can cure a rainy day.
I can't change the laws of physics.
Now in standard orbit, sir.
Welcome, everyone, to Standard Orbit, Trek FM's dedicated podcast that covers the original and new cast of Captain Kirk and the Enterprise. I am Ken Tripp.
And I am Zach Moore. And, you know, TOS had 79, 80 episodes, but there are dozens of scripts, story ideas, memos that turned into story ideas that didn't turn into other episodes that didn't make it to the big screen. Big screen, small screen. To me, the TOS screen is always a big screen. But, you know, we thought it'd be fun to pick a few of these episodes and talk about it because, you know, there's nothing like finding out stories or deleted. It's like deleted scenes, but they didn't weren't film, but, you know, just scripted things that could have happened. It's a great what if in Star Trek if several of these stories had come to the screen, Ken.
Yeah, it is, Zach. And, you know, there were obviously a lot of stories that were written for Phase 2, and these weren't. These were other stories that were actually slotted to be created or in the idea phase back when the original series was on the air. And I think you did a really good job kind of pulling these out of the archives. So, like I said, a lot of people are familiar with those Phase 2 stories that did wind up in The Next Generation. And we were having some fun with that this week in Facebook. But I really enjoy going through these kind of outlines and so forth, and I hope the people that are listening to this will as well, because this will be some interesting feedback, especially now that we've got a new series on the air, and kind of in that same timeline, you know, would this stuff still be, workable, you know, and would they draw people's interest? So you found some good stories here.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a good point you bring up about Phase 2. I feel like most people, when they think about lost Star Trek scripts, they think about Star Trek Phase 2. There's a whole book about it by the Reeve Stevens, and several scripts exist out there. A couple of them were turned into next-gen episodes. So, but these are not those. These are episodes that were actually written for the original series in the 60s. So tie into to current events, the first episode we're going to talk about today is called Deep Mud. And I guess they wanted to keep using mud as a pun entirely the cue of his day, I guess, right, Ken?
That's right. It was, guess that's the way they were going with this bad boy, and it seemed to follow through the animated series as well.
Yeah, so Mud's passion was not this script. There are other episodes, you know, and you know, if this is this takes off, Ken, we might make this a little sub series here on Standard Orbit about the lost episodes of TOS, because there's dozens of them, dozens and dozens of them.
No, there is. And, you know, what's interesting, Zach, too, is, you know, another podcast, and we've done it ourselves, I think. I know we did it with Aaron one time, or I did it with Aaron one time, where we started creating kind of our own story, our own storyline with Bichet. And that's fun to do. I don't know if it's as interesting, though, for the listeners as it is for the people trying to be creative. And when you go back and you look at scripts that have been written by the staff and the team that were already involved, or at least the outlines of these scripts, it's really fascinating. And I think it adds a little bit more, in my mind anyway, credibility, because in some cases, these were going to air. They just canceled the show at a certain point, and some of these got cut off.
Yeah, absolutely. So this episode, Deep Mud, written by Stephen Candle, the Mud author himself. He wrote all the Mud episodes, both on TOS and TAS, and actually wrote a novel as well, I believe. about mud. They keep, you know, in the novels, I don't know if you've seen, Kim, but they keep that trend up. I think it's like mud in your eye, or you know, mud below, sky above. You know, that really yeah. They really play into like, oh look, his name is a noun, let's use it. But this is actually going to be a direct sequel, Deep Mud, to iMud, with his escape from the android planet. And the synopsis is basically he escapes from the planet. He tricked the robots to revealing to him the location of all their technology. And, of course, as any good charming rogue does, he goes around and sells it. And of mm-hmm. course, this technology gets sold to a group of pirates. Hijinks ensue. And the Enterprise has to get him out of his own mess yet again. So what are your thoughts on this, Ken? First of all, would you like to have seen Harry Mudd a third time on the original series?
Sure. You know, it's kind of like Q to me, the original series. Obviously very, very different characters, but similar, you know, because they both come into the show. I think they add value. They add a little bit of levity to it, although the first Mudd was pretty heavy, I guess. But, you know, his character was a lot of fun. And I know through the lens of today, there's a lot of conversations and controversy, I guess, but no, I would have liked to have seen Roger Carmel come back again and again a few times. I think, you know, he, depending too, right? When you do 26, back then they were doing 26 episodes a season, which is incredible. And, you know, you might have those episodes that get really serious or whatnot. And then, you know, you get that episode where you can get a little bit lighter and have more fun with it. And I think that, you know, that's what Harry Mudd would have done for the TOS if that had continued on, like Q did and John DeLancey did for TNG.
Now, I spent a lot of time talking about the puns and names, but actually a plot point of this episode would have been the pirates and the crew. They end up on a planet filled with a surface of molten, vicious mud, whatever that means, right? Like quicksand or... Like, I'm not sure, like, are we getting a little too literal with the mud references here, guys?
It gets a little deep. No. Oh, I did it. I didn't mean to do that. But anyway, we move on. So this story in itself, though, is pretty cool. I like it. You know, you have the pirates out there, which I think is pretty neat. There's always rogues out in space, right? And it really wasn't... And we had hippies. We really didn't have pirates in TOS. And I think that would have been, you know, fairly interesting to have kind of this rogue element out there that you're selling weapons to and all that. I like that. And of course, you know, Mudd being Mudd, he gets himself in over his head, and the Enterprise not only needs to rescue him but defeat the pirates and then get rid of all the weapons and stuff that he stole from the founders who made the android. So I think that this would have been a really fun episode to create. And you know, it kind of reminds me a little bit with what they did with Mudd in Discovery, right? He was definitely an arms dealer. He was a bad guy, and we saw that. And this kind of hints at it. Now, you know, the writers for Discovery have really dived. I don't know what the right word is. They really went deep into a lot of things TOS and Enterprise. We've seen that. So I wonder if there's elements of this script that kind of found its way into the second episode with Mudd and Discovery. I guess more to follow on that. But yeah, this would have been a good romp, quote unquote, and fun to watch. And, you know, I know there's a lot of people going, oh, not another Mudd story. Well, you know, he works for me. What can I tell you?
Yeah, a point about how they get rid of the weapons. They have to do the what I call the classic Superman maneuver and throw them into the sun. Because if you know, Superman solves most of his problems in the movies by throwing things into space or throwing things into the sun. And that would have been interesting to see. I can only imagine the TOS special effects. You would just see like a stock shot of the Enterprise, then like a blinking light come out of it and go into the sun. So it probably wouldn't have been that impressive. But you know, a very lofty script. You know, you have an interactive planet environment. You got pirates, you know, a ship you would have to see, I assume, unless they did one of their classic, oh, they're far out of visual range, Captain things, and then you're shooting stuff into the sun and then trying to show off this amazing technology as well. Would have been a challenge for, you know, being the third season of TOS with this, which is what this was written for, with their already cut budget. And then ultimately, the reason why this episode didn't happen is Roger C. Carmel, he was unavailable at the time. He was shooting a movie because he was, you know, a popular character actor at the time. And so that's literally the only reason why we didn't get this episode. in season 3 TOS. So there it is. I'm not the biggest Mud fan as you. I guess the episodes never really appealed to me. I mean, comedy doesn't date that well a lot of times, and maybe that's why of the two episodes I do prefer I Mud. That's more fun to me. Mm-hmm. And the animated show is fine, and of course Discovery is a whole different Mud, but I do like how he was doing different things in each episode. You know, he wasn't doing the same thing over and over. He was a con man, but he had many cons going on. So shows some shades to his character. He's not just one note. He has a different scheme every time they come across him. So that's fun.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. I disagree with you on the fact that I always enjoyed Harry Mudd. I thought he was a fun character. And like I said, if the series kept going on, he would have been that nice reoccurring kind of centered, because obviously it was one of the few things that kind of tied all the different storylines together and showed the passage of time, right? Because it was very, use a term from beyond, right? It was very episodic. So this kind of brought some continuity into the original series.
That's a good point. Yeah, he is the continuity point. He's always the argument people make for, hey, look, when all these fan shows, right? They bring back old stories or guest stars, and like, hey, look, TOS did it. They brought back Harry Mudd. So that is a good point there. Other than any member of the crew, obviously that recurred, main cast or guest cast, he is the only recurring character of TOS proper. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just like the crew, he could disappear. You wouldn't know why, and then they're back again. Okay.
All right, well, let's move on to the next episode we want to talk about today, The Joy Machine. This was written by Theodore Sturgeon, who wrote A Mock Time and as well as Shore Leave, a prolific science fiction author. So, Ken, do you want to talk to us a little bit about The Joy Machine, what this is all about?
Yeah, so this was supposed to be in the second season, right? And it dealt with a Federation colony that got addicted to this machine. I guess the way it would work, it was connected directly to the center of the brain, right? The pleasure center, quote unquote. And instead of pay, these workers would get hours of joy for the work that they performed. So the story was really, it's described in the outline as being highly cerebral and no real action in it. But it was all about like a completely different concept, right? Where people work for different things, and in this case, they work for pleasure, and no way to get there, right? And these people, I guess, were impacted by that, right? It was doing damage to their brains, and so the whole concept was, I from what I understand, the Enterprise goes and meets up with these folks, and they never really flushed it out as to what I think would have been the inevitable Kirk deactivating the machine, right? So that people could be focused on, instead of, going into fantasy land or virtual reality or whatever it is, could be focused on living, and getting that definition of what life is, through hard work, through whatever means, you begin to achieve things versus, get quote unquote stimulated. Interesting definition. So I think this would have been, an interesting concept if it could have been pulled through. The other thing that was interesting about this is that Shatner was tagged to direct it.
Right, so right. Fred
that
Freiberger,
would have been real interesting, yeah.
Fred Freiberger resurrected this idea, the story concept, for the third season, but they still couldn't crack the story. They reworked it a few times. They introduced a love interest to Scotty. That's how you know it's the third season. When who's falling in love this week, right? on the third season. That would have been, this would have been the fifth, the 25th episode of season 3. So it was because NBC canceled Star Trek after Trinity Bound Intruder 24 episodes in season 3. This episode did not get put into production. So I'm sure this was always the chip on Shatner's shoulder that he never got to direct an episode, because literally the next episode he was going to direct. How frustrating would that be if you were him, right?
Yeah, and interesting too, right? Because we've talked a lot about Turnabout Intruder and kind of, the way the series ended. And, really other than TNG and DS9, a lot of people argue that the other series endings were kind of flat, or in TOS's case, it just was just done, right? There was no goodbye, there was nothing.
Right.
And because that was such a controversial episode, and there were things that were said in it to this day that drive people crazy, that don't think it's real Star Trek, that there could have been opportunities to, you know, kind of pull things back to center and maybe rewrite and change some of the things that occurred in Turnabout Intruder. And this is a very interesting, very deep episode. I wonder if following an episode like Turnabout Intruder, if this would have worked. It's interesting, it's deep, but the show might have needed a different kind of kick in order to kind of pull out of Turnabout Intruder's impact. My thoughts, but interesting that it was going to be made. Interesting that Shatner was going to direct it, and maybe I'm wrong. Maybe the ending would have been completely different from what we're talking about. It's funny that they got to a certain point and then they just said, we're canceling the show. And they never flushed out the, how this was going to be corrected. So, interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah, this was actually turned into a novel in the 90s by James Gunn. Not that James Gunn. Not from Guardians of the Galaxy. A different James Gunn. And I've actually never read this novel. Have you, Ken?
No, I haven't. I hadn't heard of the term Joy Machine until you had dug this out of the archives.
It's funny. I remember seeing this book, like, on the shelf. Because, I was... As a good young nerd, I would always go to, like, the science fiction section of bookstores. And, back in the 90s, right? It's like the golden age of Star Trek expanded media. Books and toys and everything. So you go to, like, Barnes & Noble or Borders, right? Rest in peace. and, like, there's a whole shelf of Star Trek books. It's amazing. If you want a similar experience now, you have to go to, like, Half Price Books, which is fine with me. I love going to Half Price Books. And I love when all you guys at the Babel Conference post, like, I went to the thrift store today. I came back with 50 Star Trek novels for $5. It's always fun to see that. But yeah, there's a lot of TOS novels I have not read, and this is one of them. So I'd be interested if any of you guys out there have read it. Let us know what you think. Did the story work? Do you feel like it was a retread? Because, I look at this and I think part of it's kind of a retread. I think about, like, This Side of Paradise or Return of the Archons or something like that.
Yeah, and it's like I said, it's a similar theme with probably a similar ending.
But at the same time, though, it's like if you spin it the right way, who knows how they would have actually done it? Because like you said, they couldn't crack the story, and then like, we're canceled, so forget it. It sounds like it'd be like an episode of like something like The Black Mirror or something, right? This like technology, like this insidious technology that people get addicted to. That there's technically not anything wrong with it, but technically there is, and it's a really weird kind of ahead of its time, forward thinking thing, because we're seeing it right now, right? We see just now technology is catching up to all these sci-fi concepts that have been warning us about the end of humanity for so long, getting plugged into the Matrix or whatever, virtual reality and whatnot. So who knows? The real challenge of this episode, I think, would be visualizing and articulating what joy would be for everyone. As we recall from the Nexus, right, it was supposed to be a blanket of joy, right? So as Guinan said, right? So, and then we saw that. I'm like, really? I'm not really sold on that. So I think it would have been especially difficult. I mean, they might not even done anything. Might have had just somebody put on a helmet, right? And then you don't see what they see. That might have been the best. Leave it to your own imagination. Because I really don't think how they could have portrayed that in the 60s.
You think they could have pulled the colander back out from Spock's brain?
Yeah, they've just been repainted. Exactly. That was a cool prop, though. I would not fault them for using it again. So
I would love to have that prop. I really would. I don't know why. And it came back again in Ghostbusters. Remember?
Was that
Rick Moranis wearing that thing?
That's true. That and Doc from Back to the Future when he meets Marty the first time he comes out of his house.
See, that can be an origin show all by itself.
Yes. The giant
just not a Star Trek origin.
and last thing I want to say about this is I don't know if an episode like this would have inspired the TNG episode The Game or not, but it's the same kind of idea. I think, like, something that that kind of takes over. There's an insidious undercurrent to something that on the surface seems like it's just joy, right?
Well, so, I don't know if you read this, Zach, and this is true. I'm not joking around. The CDC has actually made gaming an addiction, a true disease.
Hmm.
So it's a real problem, and you can see how that can happen. I do know quite a few people that are really into gaming and networking and so forth, and they literally, spend hours and hours and hours in these words. And I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of people that are listening to this going, yeah, I can relate to that. So it is interesting that it has now been officially diagnosed as a disease, like alcoholism and addiction. Game addiction is now a disease. And it, you know, doesn't surprise me 1 ounce when I see, you know, what a huge industry this is and the way people follow it. You know, fortunately for me, you know, it's just something I was never really good at. And I tend to be like, well, it's not something I really want to be that great at anyway. There's other things that interest me. And there's nothing wrong with, I'm not judging people that play a lot of video games. I'm not. We all, you know, if my thing is movies, yours is video games, and whatever. But it is interesting that we have arrived at that point.
Yeah, that's a great point. Star Trek looking forward again as well. And again, everything in moderation, people, right? I mean, that's the whole moral of the story here. Everything in moderation, right? If your entertainment is taking up 80% of your life, maybe time to reassess, you know, how you're distributing your time, because time is valuable. Time is the fire in which we burn, Ken. So,
so you've got a good mix of a Kirk speech and Soren speech kind of brought it together. That's not easy to do, Zach, but I'm very impressed. I'm very impressed. You could have written the ending for this movie, for this episode.
Yes. Oh, man. So the Godhead would be our next episode. And the Joy Machine would have been the 25th episode of season 3. The Godhead would have been the 26th episode of season 3, the true season and true series finale of Star Trek. And this is written by John Meredith Lucas, who was a producer and writer on the original series. And the story was about, it's actually a pretty interesting concept. And I can't put my finger on if I've heard this exact same concept before in sci-fi, but it does sound like some like Arthur C. Clarke story or something you'd hear. And it's about an alien race who created a way to accumulate their vast knowledge and placing it into the mind of one selected individual. And that person would be called the Godhead. But they would become too powerful and delusional by all this. And in the episode, the drama of the episode would be they decided to take over the Enterprise and conquer the galaxy. So it was gonna go into production, but again, NBC canceled Star Trek after Turnabout Intruder, and it never got to come to pass. So what do you think of that, Ken? That does sound kind of like an old school sci-fi concept, huh?
Yeah, I like the concept a lot. It's, you know, it kind of reminds me a little bit, you know, I think of The Inner Light, how all that information was downloaded to Picard. Very different concept and goal, by the way. And then you take, you know, some of the plot elements that we've seen in future TNG episodes from this point, where, you know, Moriarty or whatever, you know, Barclay, I'm sorry,
yeah,
the engineer, right? that happens to him. That is exactly what happens. He accumulates all this knowledge to, again, not for the purpose, not that he goes in crazy, because he already was a little nuts, but so you see elements of that, and I love both those stories. And so I think from this perspective, obviously it's a little bit more intriguing, it's a little bit more nefarious, you know, and you have to find a way to defeat a presence that supposedly has all this accumulated data and knowledge. That's incredible. That would obviously not be easy. However, deities are Kirk's speciality.
Exactly. That's exactly what I was thinking. This would have been another entry into our Battle of the Gods, right? Another guy to fight. And so on that point, I think this is a different angle on it, at least, because it's kind of like, it's kind of like Data, right? Because he has all the knowledge of all the colonists from Ocon Theta. So there's lots of shades of this in future science fiction. So this person, this Godhead, would have all the experiences and knowledge of a whole race of people, which is very interesting. And it also kind of reminds me of Brainiac, the Superman villain. I'm on Superman Superman on the brain today. But he would accumulate all knowledge of a planet and then destroy that planet, because then the knowledge would become more valuable that way. So lots of ways you could take this concept. Although I don't know how it does kind of seem like, okay, we got to stop Apollo, we got to stop Gary Mitchell, we got to stop this, we got to stop that. If the Joy Machine would have been the classic Kirk defeats the computer, the Godhead would be the classic Kirk defeats the false deity, right?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, how do they, one of the concepts that I guess it's a little bit interesting to me is, you know, it's in an individual, or is it in individuals? That's a little bit, you know, it sounds like it's one person, mm-hmm. right, has all this. So, you know, I guess that it makes it a little bit more simpler to defeat. And you wonder also, would that individual then be downloading this information into the Enterprise, and the Enterprise and the individual being one entity?
That's cool. I like that.
Yeah. And that would make it, I think, a little bit more intriguing on how they would defeat it and get their arms around it. And to me, that's, yeah, it could be fun. It's definitely TOS, though, and it fits in with what they had been doing for 3 years. And, you know, in some of those episodes, yeah, okay, it's a tired kind of plot thread. But if you can improve on it and make it more interesting, there's nothing wrong with it. You know, it's certainly, if you look at all the other Star Trek series, this is not something that you would say, oh, this couldn't work. Yeah, I think it could work.
And as we often say, I feel like if these two episodes, Joy Machine and Godhead, would have happened, Turnabout Intruder would be looked at with a little less vitriol, because it just would have kind of faded into the background, because it's the last episode of TOS. People just kind of, it's a lightning rod, right? It's like, oh, it's that last episode, it was bad, and they had all these unwoke things about it, to use a common vernacular. It would have kind of been more the soften the blow of it with these other two episodes at the end, which, you know, sound like interesting concepts. Now, the thing about when you talk about these episodes that are never made, it's always, you know, it's always in the execution, right? Because, you know, you could list off some of the worst TOS episodes, and they sound like a really interesting concept, right? Even, like, In the Children Shall Lead sounds like an interesting concept. Like, go to some planet where there's, like, mass suicide and only the children are there. I'm like, oh, that sounds like a terrible horror story. But then you see what they did with it, and you're like, oh, okay, well, never mind. So it's always that that missing component there. But yeah, you know, I would are you familiar at all with John Byrne's photo novels for the new what he does for IDW Comics?
No, I'm not.
So John Byrne, he's a famous comic book author and Star Trek comic book author as well. And what he's done, he's taken those photo novels like from the 70s, and he does new versions of them. He makes completely new episodes based off old, you know, production stills and screenshots, and, you know, HD screenshots have completely changed the world for that. So what he does is it's a monthly or bi-monthly or comic book release, and what he does is he makes completely new Star Trek episodes and stories out of these images. And so what I think would be interesting is if he actually took those and made photo novels of these. It's called Star Trek New Visions, by the way. I recommend everybody, if you're a TOS fan, you need to be checking that out. It's a kick. But I would love for him to make the Godhead and Deep Mud and the Joy Machine and all these other episodes we hopefully will have a chance to talk about in the future, because that'd be the closest thing to getting the real episode, I think, would be these photo novels. And that would be a cool way to visualize what could have been. So.
Yeah. I wonder how difficult it would be for him to get the rights to do it, or, you know, the license to do it. I'm guessing what he's doing is his own, right? He's coming up with his own plot points, or
yeah, he's basically creating everything. So yeah, that probably is a something they'd have to buy the script or the rights to the script or whatnot, because it's obviously someone else's intellectual property. Although I don't know if they had it, depending on how these scripts worked back in the day, if they had to what was the term? There is a business terminology that I cannot remember right now, but it's basically where you're working for another company and you write something, it becomes them, becomes their, like well, that's the whole problem with
IP, yeah, intellectual property.
Yeah, but it's the whole reason that you have all these lawsuits between, again, Superman on the brain, right? The families of Siegel and Schuster who created Superman were like suing DC Comics, right. Somebody out there will know what I'm talking about, but basically it's like, hey, thanks, you were an employee of DC Comics at the time, but you created this, so it's ours now.
Well, if it's copyrighted, it's owned by the company, right? If you did it, and so same thing. I mean, we call in my world it's IP, intellectual property, and that's what we're always.
It's like work to pay per work or something. I don't know. But anyway, what a tangent, right? But what?
Yeah, that went to a direction we haven't got an ending to. So, you know, for all those people that are out there, Schindler, Aaron, I'm sure you guys know this stuff. All these folks that understand this, these things and go into making productions, film, you know, all of it. I'm sure they would know this stuff.
Mm-hmm. So, of these three episodes, then, Ken, which one intrigues you the most to have seen? Which one do you wish, if you had to pick one of them, which do you wish you would have seen?
I might have had the most interesting plot, I thought, with the pirates. I don't know why. It's not just Mud, which, you know, is interesting to me. But I do like the idea of pirates in the Federation. I just think that's kind of cool and new. The other two are very interesting, and they look good. It's just we've seen elements of them before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of leaning toward the Droid Machine. It just sounds very, very interesting, very ahead of its time to me. But mm-hmm. again, it's all in the execution. We'll see. I guess I kind of know what to expect from Mud Episode. So maybe that's why I gravitate toward the unknown of the Droid Machine. But
yeah, like I said, to me, and I have probably a 2018 vision in my head of, probably from watching Discovery and all the later series, pirates and so forth would be really cool. Would they really be able to pull it off back in 1967? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But it would have been fun, I think, if they could come up with enough money to actually come up with a quote-unquote pirate ship and all that stuff. It's intriguing to me. That's all. It sounds more like a fun romp with a little action adventure in there.
Yeah, I wonder if they would have made them the Orion pirates. I think about the animated series, and there's the Pirates of Orion, right? And it's like these, mm-hmm. green guys, and that would have been cool. A little more Star Trek. I don't know if that would have been the budget to paint people green in season three. More than one person anyway. Maybe we'd only mm-hmm. see one of them. that would be the key to save money, like the Gorn, right? Here's the captain. There's nobody else, just the captain here. So that's one way to do that's it, right. too. So, but yeah, it's fun to look back on these what ifs of Star Trek, man. And of course, I wish there were more episodes of the original series. That way, we'd have more to talk about here on Standard Orbit, right, Ken?
Absolutely, absolutely. But this is episode 205, and it's between the armies of folks that have been working on this podcast for quite a while, we've been able to keep it going with new and exciting ways of looking at it. So yeah, it would have been nice, but then I also don't want to get into the trap of being a commentary podcast, episode to episode.
Right.
I'll leave that to you and Bichet to have your fun. And, he's pinging on you for the Savage Curtain, man. So, whenever you're ready to do it with him, he's ready.
Well, that's on the list. We got a long way to go here. We try to space those out,
So. Absolutely. Absolutely. But I think that you make a good point. And, that's why I love the new cast piece of it. And hopefully, Tarantino will give us something to really talk about in the next 2 or 3 years.
Man, if the Tarantino movie doesn't come through, we're gonna look back at this like batch of episodes here where we're all excited. We're gonna be so disappointed.
I'm optimistic it'll work out. In the cast of the JJ universe, the Kelvin timeline seemed like they would really be excited to do it. So if there was some timidity in coming back and making a fourth movie or whatnot. Tarantino has a way of pulling in of people and people, instead of him having to go out and cast, people come to him to say, I want to be in this movie. So that's why I'm optimistic. I am optimistic by nature because I'm a Star Trek fan.
There you go. Optimism.
I mean, old school Star Trek fan,
I'll just call you Dr. Phlox from now on. We do everything.
I don't know if I want that one. No thanks.
Well, this being TOS, we do everything by threes. Three seasons of TOS, the big three: Kirk, Spock, and McCoy. We talked about three episodes today. There are three Kelvin timeline movies. Maybe that's a sign. The original series movies, there were six, which is two sets of three. So you can cut it any way you want. Do some math there, but we'll see. But that's gonna do it for our conversation today. We just wanted to talk about these three episodes, and hopefully you guys. Have some thoughts and let us know. Yeah, if you've read The Droid Machine, let us know. I'd be curious if it's worth my time to read that one because there are so many Star Trek novels. You have to be very selective. If any of y'all have any preferences of like, hey, I like this episode, I like that one, let us know which of these three you would like to have seen on the screen in the 60s. So let us know in the Babel Conference or on Twitter or anywhere you can find us on social media. But the lost episodes of TOS aren't the only thing we're talking about on Trek.fm this week. Here's a quick look at what else we've been doing on the network.
Previously on Trek.fm, Earl Grey.
I actually hadn't watched the show, I'm embarrassed to say, but I sat down and I started watching and recording episodes, and I immediately had an idea for a script because I found Data to be the most interesting character.
To the journey!
So you could have, carbonated gug.
Carbonated gog.
I'm trying to understand how this works. So the Gawk are presumably a little squishy or juicy on the inside. So you're saying that in order to give them the appearance of life, they replicate it with carbonation inside the Gawk.
Yes, to make them like pop and fizz. Kind of like an Alka-Seltzer, you know?
Like pop fizz, fizz. Candy Gawk.
Warp 5.
And I go into the job interview, and I'm just parroting back to him things he said in his interviews, but he didn't know that I was just doing that. I would say, the thing about Star Trek is that you could write a mystery one week, and a Western the next week, and I'm literally word for word things he said in interviews. So that's how I always feel, and I joke with him now that that's how I got the job, but...
The 602 Club.
When we're talking about the idea of context in history, I think this is the biggest issue that I see in this film. And with the Force Awakens too, and you put them together because they're going to make a trilogy, is look, writing 101, if you don't know the past and the future of your characters, you absolutely 100% cannot write their present.
And that's what else is happening on Trek.fm.
So check out these shows and find out what we're talking about in your favorite corner of the Star Trek universe and beyond. You'll find us wherever you get your podcasts. If you're an Apple user, get the show on iTunes or the Apple Podcasts app. Be sure to hit the subscribe button. That helps us greatly and makes it easier for other listeners to find the show. If you're not an Apple user, we've got you covered as well. You can find our shows on Stitcher, TuneIn, Speaker, SoundCloud, Windows Phone, and of course, you can stream and download the MP3 file from our website and grab the RSS link as well.
If you'd like to get in touch with us here at Trek FM, you can always find us on trekfm.com/contact. And look in the sidebar on the show page, or you can go to speakpipe.com/trekfm, and please leave us a voice message. You can also contact us through Twitter at trekfm, or on Facebook at facebook.com/trekfm, and of course in the Babel Conference. Type Babel Conference, that's B-A-B-E-L, into the search field on Facebook, or go to our website at trekfm and click discussion on the menu bar. Another way you can help us keep all of our shows coming to you each week is to become a patron on the network on Patreon. If you visit patreon.com/trekfm, that's patreon.com/trekfm, you'll find the current goals and different milestone contributions along with all the great perks we have for you. These perks include early access to content, exclusive content, producer credits, seats on our content development team, and more. We really appreciate any support you can give us and hope you'll join the team. Again, you'll find all the details on patreon.com/TrekFM. Speaking of Patreon, thank you as always to our great associate producers for Standard Orbit. We have Renee Roberts, Norman Lau, Aaron Harvey, Tim Robertson, Nick Anastasio, Richard Marquez, and Corey Elrod.
Yes, thank you guys so much for your support for both Standard Orbit and Trek FM. So Ken, if people want to find you out there on the internet, where can they find you?
You can find me hanging around the Babel Conference and engaging people when I have the opportunity. You can also find me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @BostonSCPO, and we like to tweet out all our new episode information as soon as we get it, as well as our colleagues. So look for me there.
As for me, you can find me on Twitter at MoronZach. That's MoreOnZach. And I'm also the host of my own podcast, Always Hold On to Smallville, where we talk about each and every episode of that Young Superman series from the early 2000s. And you can find us on Twitter at AlwaysMallville with one S. So thanks everyone for listening, and join us again next time here on Trek FM for another episode of Standard Orbit.